listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children to jump the very best you can. Just let it be. Na, 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 na. The world won't get no better. We gotta change it, girl. Just you and me. We got all the damages, make the old people well.
right. Welcome, everybody. We are on night four of our nightly read alouds with Dr. Ivey. That's me. We've been out of school for the last 4 days, and many of you have asked again why I am doing this. And for all the new folks that are joining in, really, this is to really take me out of my comfort zone, because a lot of local educators, not only here in Sumter where I live, but across the great state of South Carolina, are stepping up, and they are really doing something unprecedented, which is to redesign completely their teaching and learning experiences for their children. And so I figured that I could make one small contribution to this movement and help retain some sense of normalcy to children's lives through a nightly read aloud. And so here we are on night four. Again, my name is Trevor Ivey, and I live right here in Sumter County in the great state of South Carolina. I know we have a lot of new folks joining us, and we have several states that are represented already that I see in the comment section, and I know others will be able to access this later when it is time for them to go to bed. So if you're just joining us tonight for your first night, this has changed a little bit over the last couple of nights. We first started with just a simple read aloud, but then I listened to some of the feedback that was provided, and many that shared their feedback wanted some additional activities, and to be more specific, activities that parents could actually do with their child while they are home in this quarantine that we're in. I hope you're all practicing your social distancing. So we're going to do that again tonight. And I've got a very special book. It happens to be one of my all-time favorite children's read alouds, and I'm so excited to share that with you. But before we get started, I want to just remind you of where we left off last night. We had a challenge that Dr. Ivey issued to everyone that listened in, and it followed up with one of our read alouds from earlier this week called If I Built a House. And if you remember, the main character, Jack, designed a house of the future. He just didn't want any boring house. He wanted an exciting house. And so he completely redesigned his home following the steps of the engineering design process, which is something we've been looking at the last couple of nights. And so my challenge to all the boys and girls that were listening in was to go back and to take the solution that you design and actually build a model of your house of the future. And I was blown away with the responses that we received today. I narrowed it down to about seven. And so I want to first thank all of those parents that sent in their videos, and those children, scholars who actually recorded themselves sharing the metacognition behind their thinking about why they wanted certain rooms in their houses to be a certain way. And so if you haven't taken a moment to vote, and I shared the top seven, this is the last post on my Facebook page, if you'll take just a moment to go back and pick one or like all seven of them. But I am going to again declare a winner. I need your help, everybody that's tuning in. So please help me decide who is our overall winner. And you can again find that post on my page using your second internet connected device. That's one of our materials tonight. So is it going to be Selah, who wanted a pool in her backyard? Is it going to be Jessie, who had a floating bed with an LED light above her bed? I love the energy conservation concept that she featured in her design. Or is it going to be Autumn? Autumn took a page from our read aloud and wanted a ball pit in her bedroom, but changed it up just a bit to have a robot beanbag chair. I thought that was brilliant. Randy is also featured. He not only wanted to have one trampoline in his bedroom, like Jack did in the book, he put three trampolines in his bedroom. But look at Carisi's. I love Carisi's picture that was submitted. She actually incorporated some additional technology and went into a special program, the paint program on the computer, And she actually designed her house of the future using that paint program, named her robot Robin, and Robin's task was to hang up all of her clothes. So I know that probably Carisi doesn't like to hang up clothes, so I thought that was pretty brilliant. But while you're there, make sure you check out Ben. Ben has been joining us the last several nights and participated in last night's engineering design challenge. And he actually used household items, Legos, to build his future house. Check it out. But then you also have Jalen. So you want to check out Jalen's video. She's the last one that is featured on our poll tonight. She has a pretty incredible model, I must admit. It takes you from start to finish. And her closet is very special because she has a robot in her closet that will dress her when she first wakes up and steps in, and then it's like an assembly line in her model that gets you ready for the day, as she calls it. So again, take a moment to go on my page and vote for your favorite challenge to the future house design. I'll be sharing the winner or winners at the very end of our time together tonight. Parents, we will have a parent university session after our read aloud tonight in our challenge, so hang around if you're interested in that. But let's go ahead and get started with our read aloud tonight. So on our roll call tonight, I ask that you share in, if you're comfortable, your name, where you're from, and parents, what are some special things about your child or your children? And so it was exciting to see some of the comments that were posted in the comment section, because that is going to get us primed and ready for the activity for tonight. So without any further ado, I want to go ahead and begin our read aloud for night four of our school closure. One of my all-time favorite books, Stand Tall, Molly Lou Melon. So boys and girls, from the last several nights, Dr. Ivey has been going over with you some great literacy strategies that good readers incorporate when they read. Now, I shared with you that I used to be a science teacher, but you know what? Good scientists have to know how to read and read really well. Because you know, as Dr. Seuss said, the more you read, the more you know, the more you know, the more places you'll go. So, looking at our front cover of the book, we have our title. Good readers are always going to take a picture walk through their book to make sure that this is a book that they might want to read. And so I am going to model for you how to do that picture walk. And it looks like it is a pretty exciting book. It looks engaging, so I am definitely going to check it out and read it. And so the next strategy that I'm going to look at is, let's find out some information about the book and the person who wrote it and the person who drew the pictures. We've been talking about that, and it's very important that we know who the author and the illustrator is. Looking at the bottom cover of our book, Stand Tall, Molly Lou Melon is written by Patty Lovell and it's illustrated by David Catro. I wonder what this book is going to be about. Take a moment to share with your parent, your sibling, or your fuzzy friend that is next to you what you predict this book is going to be about. Do you have your prediction? All right, let's begin. Molly Lou Melon stood just taller than her dog, but she was the shortest girl in all of first grade. But she didn't mind. Her grandma had told her to walk as proudly as you can, and the world will look up to you. Wow, Molly Lou Melon was pretty short. So she did. Molly Lou Melon had buck teeth that stuck out so far she could stack pennies on top of them. But she didn't mind. her grandma had told her, smile big and the world will smile right alongside you. Well, she has a special grandma, doesn't she? So she did! Wow! Molly Lou Melon had a voice that sounded like a bullfrog being squeezed by a boa constrictor. But she didn't mind. Her grandma had told her to sing out clear, loud, and strong, and the world will cry tears of joy. So many things that make Molly Lou Melon special. So she did. Molly Lou Melon was often fumble-fingered, but she didn't mind. Her grandma had told her to believe in yourself and the world will believe in you too. Mean to be fumble-fingered? Well, good readers, if they're not sure as to what the text means, they can look at the pictures. It looks like this could be another way of saying she was clumsy, fumble-fingered. So she did! What do you think is going to happen next? Let's find out. Then, all of a sudden, Molly Lou Melon had to move to a new town. She had to say goodbye to her grandma and all of her friends. Boys and girls, how do you think Molly Lou Melon feels right now? Sad, right? Have any of you ever had to say goodbye to someone that you love? Maybe even your friends to move to a new town? I know I have. And on top of that, she had to start in a new school. On the first day of school, Ronald Durkin called her Shrimpo in gym class. But when the game started, Molly Lou Melon caught the football. She ran underneath the legs of Ronald Durkin and she scored a touchdown for the team. All the children stood on the sidelines and thought, wow, she's pretty good. And Ronald Durkin felt very foolish. On the second day at her new school, Ronald Durkin called Molly Lou Melon Bucky Tooth Beaver. But Molly Lou Melon, remember what her grandma said? She took out her pennies and she stacked 10 of them right high up on her teeth and she smiled as big as day. All the children smiled with glee and Ronald Durkin felt very foolish. Boys and girls, do you see where Ronald Durkin is in the picture? All the other children are smiling with glee. On the third day of school, Ronald Durkin said to Molly Lou Melon, "You sound like a sick duck, honk, honk." Molly Lou Melon then sang out a quack, so clear, loud, and strong that it made Ronald Durkin somersault backwards, hit his head on the rock, and have to go see the school nurse. All the children cried with joy to be free from Ronald Durkin for the rest of the afternoon. And Ronald Durkin felt very foolish. Have you ever had someone say mean things to you before? On the fourth day at her new school, Ronald Durkin told Molly Lou Melon that she made the snowflake in class all wrong. But Mama Lou Melon opened up her paper, and it revealed the most beautiful snowflake of all. All the children went, ooh, ah, even Ronald Durkin. On the fifth day of school, Ronald Durkin brought Molly Lou Melon a stacking penny for her tooth and smiled at her. That very same night, Molly Lou Melon took out a pencil and paper and wrote this letter to her grandma. It wrote, "Dear Grandma, I wanted to tell you that everything you told me was exactly right. Love, Molly Lou Melon." Wasn't that an excellent book, boys and girls? I really enjoy reading that book. So now, boys and girls, we're going to have a short discussion to make sure that you had on your listening ears during our read aloud tonight. So I'm going to ask you a couple of questions about the book. What does the word encouragement mean? What does the word encouragement mean? Why should you encourage someone? Do you like to be encouraged? Do you like to hear good things said about you? I think all of us would say yes. Encouragement means to be praised, to be motivated, and to not stop. And when we start to encourage others, they provide positive feedback that recognizes what are the beautiful things about this person. So my question to you is, who was Molly's encourager in the story? Does anyone know? If you said her grandma, you are absolutely right. How did her grandma encourage her? What did her grandma do? That's right. She did many things. Her grandmother said very nice things to her. We can go into our book. That's what good readers do, to find specific examples. One example was, even though Molly's teeth were just a bit different than others, her grandma would tell her to smile big as day and the world will smile right alongside you. Another example would be, Molly's voice was a little different, right? But what did her grandma say? Her grandma told her to sing out clear, loud, and strong, to be yourself, and the world will cry tears of joy. So Ronald Durkin, what role did he play in our story tonight? That's right. Ronald Durkin was not a very nice person. In fact, you may call him the bully. Do you have bullies at your school? Well, boys and girls, you are going to have bullies that are around you. And the most important thing to stop bullying from taking place is to spread kindness and to be nice to others. But in our story, Ronald Durkin said mean things to Molly Lou Melon, right? He called her Bucky Tooth Beaver, right? That wasn't very nice. But did that stop Molly Lou Melon from being herself? No. So I want you to think about those special things that make you special. Think about some kind words you would like to be told, maybe at school, on the playground, because Molly was not hurt by these unkind words. Can you do the same? Yes, you can. You can do the same. My next question to you is, how did Ronald feel when Molly was not bothered by his unkindness? Do you remember what the author kept saying on every page? Ronald Durkin felt very foolish. Ronald Durkin felt very foolish. Molly Lou Melon wasn't listening to any of Ronald Durkin's mean comments. She was not going to have it. And a lot of times, boys and girls, you just have to ignore the mean things that other people may say about you. So to close up our activity before we get started, on our independent activity is I have this little heart right here, right? Is this what your heart looks like on the inside of you? Shake your head yes or no. I hope you're shaking your head no. If you didn't know, your heart doesn't look like this on the inside of you. This is just a representation that we use as humans. But I have a heart right here, and I want to illustrate to you the effect that saying mean things, but also saying kind things, can have on people. So let's think about some of the mean things that were said about Molly Lou Melon. What's one thing? Well, he called her Bucky Tooth Beaver, right? I'm gonna fold our heart one way. What's something else that Ronald Durkin said to Molly Lou Melon? Called her Shrimpo, right? That probably didn't make her feel good on the inside. What's something else that Ronald Durkin said to Molly Lou Melon? He criticized her for making the snowflake all wrong. That probably didn't make Molly Lou Melon feel very good. What's one more thing that Ronald Durkin said to Molly Lou Melon? That's right, and we left out the comment he made about Molly Lou Melon's voice, right? That it cracked. That probably didn't make Molly Lou Melon feel very good. And so now, we started with a really nice heart, but now it's all crinkled up. And so, what are some things that we could say to Molly Lou Melon that could make her feel good about herself, to make her feel special? What's one thing? One thing that she could hear is that she has a beautiful voice, right? We're gonna unfold one time. Something else that you could say to Molly Lou Melon is that she is very talented with the penny stacking on her teeth. That probably would make her feel really good. Instead of saying something mean about her snowflake that she may or may not have created wrong, you could say, "That's a beautiful creation that you made." Right? What's one more thing that we could say to Molly Lou Melon to make her feel special? Well, we could start by welcoming her to her new school. You ever had a new student come into your classroom? First impressions are everything. So we might say, "Welcome, Molly Lou Melon, to your new classroom. I can be your friend." And so now we have our heart back to its original shape. But you know what's one thing that is different about the heart that we've ended up with compared to the heart that we started with? I want you to take a look at it. What's one thing that is still different? Yeah, it has creases and folds in it. And boys and girls, that represents the wrinkles and the scars that one's heart would have when mean things are said to them. And even if we got an iron out and we plugged it up and we ironed it out, we probably couldn't get all the wrinkles out of it. And so we have to be careful with what we say to other people, because once we say it and it comes out of our mouth, there's no taking it back. So that's why your teachers at school are always telling you to think before you speak. Make sure that you say something positive, because if you were to say something mean to someone, you're going to hurt their heart, and it will always have that wrinkle or that scar. So for our activity tonight, you're going to need some markers. You got your markers? I've got my markers. And you're also going to need a blank sheet of paper, just like we've used the last couple of nights. All right. What I want you to do is on your paper, I want you to draw a big circle that kind of looks like a pot, like a cooking pot. That's right. a big circle that has legs on the end that represent a pot. And Dr. Ivey is almost done with his pot. And I am going to show you my pot and what it looks like. You know, the pot that your mom or dad or you may cook with on the stove. Yeah, that kind of pot. So the pot, boys and girls, is gonna look like this. All right. Now at the top of your pot, you are going to write your name, and then you're going to put an apostrophe S on it because this pot belongs to you. And you're gonna call it melting pot. So my paper has my title on it. And titles are always underlined. So this is what it's going to look like. Dr. Ivey's melting pot. So you see I've got my pot and I've got my title. So if you're sitting next to your parent or an older sibling, or your fuzzy friend, ask them, what are some special things about you? What are some things that make you special? Maybe you know some things that already make you special. Everybody has something that makes them special. Now, I want you to think of at least five things, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that make you special. And if you can be specific with just a word or two words with each of your special things, because you don't want your pot to get too much, all right? So I'm going to write those words on the inside of my pot. So stay with me. I have a few words that I am going to write in my melting pot that make me special. Do you have your five words? I have mine. Let's take a look at my example. On my melting pot, one of my words that I have is fast. I'm really, really, really fast. I don't know why, but I'm just really, really, really fast. Something else that makes me special is I'm very unique, right? There's only one of me. Something else that makes me special is I am reliable. Do you know what reliable means? Reliable means that you stay true to your word. If you say you're going to do something, you do it. I like to think that one thing that makes me special is that I'm pretty reliable. Something else that makes me special is I'm positive. I always like to have a smile on my face. It's really important, I believe, boys and girls, to have a positive attitude. Because if you have a positive attitude, you can overcome any obstacle that comes in front of you. And the last word that I put in my melting pot that describes something special about me is super. I believe I'm a super guy. And so what I would like for you to do with your words in your melting pot as part of your activity that you will work on either after our read aloud tonight or tomorrow is to write at least one paragraph, one sentence for each of the words that are in your pot. So at the end of your paper, you will have how many sentences? Five, that's right, because we had five words in our pot. So I will write out at least five sentences using the words that are in my pot. So just as I explained it to you, I would like for you to write it out. All right, boys and girls, I have one other activity that I want to share with you that goes along with our read aloud tonight, and it is my me bag. So look at my me bag. And again, this kind of goes with what we were talking about in the very beginning of our read aloud for tonight. Things that make us special. So in my bag, I have several things that make me special that I'd like to share with you. Oh, I wonder what's in my knee bag. Let's find out. Let me see what I can find. I've got one thing. Here we go. In my knee bag, I have a picture of two very special ladies in my life. The first one is my mom. Her name is Miss Debbie. The other lady here who's sticking out her tongue is my grandma. She's from Great Britain, very far, far, far away. And yes, she has a beautiful British accent. This picture is very special to me because even though my mom is no longer living, I have very special pictures like this that I can look back on. That's something that makes me special. Something else that makes me special is my cereal. I love Honey Bunches of Oats. Do you have a favorite cereal? Maybe Fruity Pebbles, Lucky Charms? Well, mine is Honey Bunches of Oats. So this is something that makes me special. Something else that makes me special? I put a mixing beater in my knee bag. What do you think that represents about something that makes me special? Well, if you said something about baking, you are absolutely right. I like to cook. I don't do a lot of it, but I do like to do it. Something else that makes me special, I put a bottle of cologne in my knee bag because I like to smell really good. Do you like to smell really good? Well, I hope so. I like to put on special cologne. Something else that makes me special in my knee bag is, I have another picture. This is a picture of my family. This is my dad. His name is Mr. Bud. This is my older sister. Her name is Miss Amber. This is my younger brother, Mr. Brandon, and this is my younger sister, Miss Cherish. We all live near each other. The other people in this picture are also very special to me. This is my sister-in-law, her name is Miss Nikki, and here are my two beautiful nieces. This is Lily, she is in fifth grade at Millwood Elementary School, and this is Kerrigan. She is in second grade at Millwood Elementary School. What's something else that makes me special? Boys and girls, this is very special to me because you may not remember, but this used to be a big sensation many, many years ago, about 4 years ago. And I rushed out and got one because I love to make other people laugh. I don't know about you, but that's one thing that makes me special. So I just had a lot of fun with my Chewbacca mask. Do you have a Chewbacca mask? Maybe not. One other thing that makes me special is, my passport. Do you know what a passport is? Passport. Well, if you said that it is something that allows you to travel, you are correct. This is something that makes me very special because I like to travel to other places around the world. In fact, it is something that is really special to me to get to all 7 continents before I turn 40. And I've made some progress, but I have a few more to get to. But you have to have a passport in order to go. But I don't think I'll be going anytime soon. So boys and girls, if you had your own me bag, what would you put in your me bag that would explain how special you are? Well, that's part 2 of my challenge tonight. Your first part is to work on your melting pot. Remember, I need 5 sentences at the bottom. And the second part is to make your own knee bag. So just like we've done for the last couple of days, if you can work with your parent to either have a recording of your melting pot, and you can explain, I'd like you to read aloud your melting pot writing to me. How many sentences? 3? Nope. 4? No. 5. That's right. And if you are in 5th grade, I expect those to be super strong sentences with great adjectives. And then also, I would like to get a picture or a video of you presenting your me bag. Because boys and girls, I feel like we have formed like a little family in our nightly read alouds. And many of you, I am getting to know or in comments that you're sharing. So I'd like to get to know more about you. And so I would like for you to record your presentation of your me bag so that I can see all of the items that are in your bag. We can't meet up, and I cannot come to your school because we are supposed to be staying away from other people in light of the current situation. So the next best thing that you can do is to make a video recording and to send it to me. All right, so I'm excited to see what responses I am going to get. So last but not least, boys and girls, I have a special poem that I want to share with you. And the poem is about a guy named Ned. Can you spell Ned's name? Ned. N-E-D. And it goes perfectly with our read aloud tonight. If you're thinking about things that make you special, if you're thinking that you don't have anything that makes you special, if you think that you have lots of people who are not nice to you, and you struggle with making friends, this poem may help you. So let's read the poem. Never give up. You know it's right, so keep on going. Keep on going, you'll shine so bright. Encourage others. That's the only way you make people feel great. By the words that you say. Do your best. Give it all you've got. Never hold back because you've got a lot. So boys and girls, remember that if no one has told you that they loved you today, Dr. Ivey is telling you right now on our nightly read aloud that he loves you. And I want you to be somebody. I want you to be someone. I want you to be someone more. So as we close our 4th night of our read aloud, let's go ahead and do our nightly reflection. So parents, if you are still with us, this is designed as a way for you to talk with your child. This is supposed to be a two-way conversation. So remember, we have 4 questions that I am asking. Question number 1, what was the best part about today? What was the best part about Thursday, your 4th day out of school, stuck at home? What was the best part? As I think about on my day, the best part about my day today was the beautiful weather that we had. I hope you got to go outside and enjoy some of the beautiful weather. Question number 2, what was the least favorite part about your day? Your least favorite part about your day. For me, the least favorite part about my day is that I ran out of eggs. I like to eat eggs in the morning for breakfast. And so I ran out of eggs, and I just realized recently that I don't have eggs for my breakfast tomorrow. So that's the least favorite part about my day today. Question number 3. If you could go back and change one thing about today, what would you change? What would you change? One thing that I would change is, well, I would have only used 2 eggs this morning instead of 3. What's one thing that you hope that is going to happen tomorrow? That is our fourth and final question. One thing that you hope is going to happen tomorrow. One thing I hope is going to happen tomorrow is that we have just as good of the weather as we had today. It was a beautiful day today. So boys and girls, thank you for joining in to our Read Aloud for tonight. Before we go and we get started with Parent University, we've got to find out who our winners are. Remember, we had 7 from last night that were posted. Is it Selah and her pool in the backyard? Is it going to be Jessie, who had a floating bed and an LED light? Is it going to be Autumn, who had a robot beanbag chair? But what about Randy? Is it going to be because of his 3 trampolines in his future house? What about Carisi and Robin, the robot that she designed for her future room? Is it going to be Ben with his Lego room of the future? Or is it going to be Jalen, who has the closet that dresses you automatically? Well, I have been checking the votes that have been coming in, and it looks like we have the most votes are going to Selah and Jessie. But boys and girls, we are all winners. And so Dr. Ivey is going to be following back up with whomever submitted your video to share a prize with you. So that'll be my way of saying thank you for participating and continuing to educate your mind while you're out of school using that special process called the engineering design process. All right, boys and girls, at this time, I am going to bid you good night. Go and get your teeth all brushed if you haven't brushed your teeth so you can get ready for bedtime. Good night. Parents that are joining in for the first time, we are going to do another session of Parent University. I've still received several questions about how an educator would respond to some of the questions that the children may be asking you about what's going on. And so I wanted just to reiterate during our Parent University tonight some of the strategies that I would incorporate into my conversations if I had a child who were asking me about what is going on around you. So I have worked with children for the last 13 years, and so I don't have any of my own, but I've had the good fortune of working with thousands of children. And this one thing that I know is that you cannot hide information from children. They are very smart and very astute individuals. So just a few things that I wanted to share with you about the situation that's going on. Number one, don't be afraid to discuss the coronavirus. Children know about the word. They may have seen news clippings with folks wearing face masks. And so this is an opportunity to talk about it with your child, because if you don't talk about it, they are just going to worry more. Number two, be developmentally appropriate in your conversations with your children. Don't volunteer too much information. This could be overwhelming to a child. And do your best to answer questions honestly. And if you don't know the answer, you can tell them, you know, I don't know, and I'm going to find out that answer for you. As educators, we do that all the time when children ask questions that we do not know the answer to. Number three, focus your conversations with your child or children about what you are doing at home to stay safe. So they probably have heard of the phrase social distancing by now. And so this is a great opportunity to illustrate for your child what that actually means and why people are being encouraged by our government leaders to do that. This is a great opportunity to reiterate to your children the importance of washing their hands for 20 seconds, singing the happy birthday song with warm water and soap. But the most important thing is to focus on what you're doing as a family to stay safe. The next piece of advice that I would share is to stick to a routine. Social media is full of lots of funny stories about children at home and parents trying to take on the role of the teacher. Our teachers are doing an amazing job, not just here locally in Sumter, but across the state and the nation. I have seen lots of positive stories on social media of teachers just stepping up and stepping out of their comfort zone to redesign their teaching and learning experiences to make them meaningful for their child. And so just remember, at school, it's just like home for this. They need a routine. And so it's very important that they stay rooted in a routine. And you could even write it out on a piece of paper and post it to the refrigerator so that children know there is a routine. You may be with your child at home for longer than just next week, right? And so you will want to make sure that you have set a routine. We all hope and pray that the curve is going to flatten, but at the end of the day, it's important that there is a set routine Monday through Friday at your house during those school hours. So think about 3 hours that your child or children should devote to the core subjects: math, social studies, science, English language arts, specials that they may go to. You can be creative and adapt at home to those. Take time for lunch, of course. You can use this Read Aloud as an opportunity to have some routine for your child. But the most important thing is to stick to a routine. So, again, thank you for joining us tonight for our nightly Read Aloud. We are going to continue tomorrow. Tomorrow's Read Aloud will be just a Read Aloud. There will be no activity. It'll be a bedtime story. And we also will have a bedtime story on Sunday. Sunday is going to be special. So make sure to spread the word about Sunday. We are going to have fun, the most fun we have had so far. I'm going to have a lot of fun, I don't know about you, on Sunday. So thank you again for joining me tonight, and I hope that you have a great night.